Gaunt eve in the morning, for when in Dublin town turn every fifth wind down. It was one of those days that seemed to make their way in without anybody noticing at all. Mrs. Arglet folded her sweaters and waited. Pretty soon, Juggy the Bully Fan arched his short, though lithe, body over the curb. Ah, yes, Mrs. Arglet thought. There's you all right, next'll be that sleazy guild postman. Ah, yes, and him all as shy as a beat-up lark on last summer's hammock. Suddenly her musing took an audible turn. I wonder, I do wonder. Just got me a hunch that do a bit of whistling, too. Him and those pretentious sleeve bands and gold-beaded moccasins of his. And yes, there he was. It's exactly 8:10. Not one iota different from any other day. There he was peering in through the wind on the sun porch, his glinty ox eye fixed on her parson. I just know I must look like a big pink sponge. Ah, the habit he get into, Mrs. Arglet said, pretending to address a stack of those old-fashioned postcards, which specialize in winter scenes and rarely skirted bathers on long closed beaches. One after the other, she lifted her woolen, salmon-colored sweaters from their adjoining stack and pressed them over her swirling chest. Behind her, a pane in the reinforced window tinkled out. Ah, damn, Mrs. Arglet thought, her blush deepening perceptibly, whether from exasperation or the sudden snuffling of her shoulder blades, it would be hard to say. It's the fourth this week already, she mumbled with a little shiver of nervous excitement. Then at last the clock was clanging the hour. Now she could breathe again. For he was gone, he was gone. When she felt her strength returned enough, she sighed into her corset, meanwhile waddling first forward, then back in the imitation hip dance she'd picked up one of her perennial Saturday night movies. It's not until she'd shrugged into her slip-and-torn kimono-style housecoat, pulled them down over her frizzy, graying hair. She permitted herself a half-petulant, half-gleeful speculation. Oh, yes, oh, yes, indeed. First, it was that great, silly, mustard mustache of yours. Then it was those two geranium pot red shredded wheats you stuck on yourself for eyebrows. Oh, yes, you sure handed me a laugh with those correspondent school disguises of yours, dearie. And next, Abbott, Why should I look ahead to spoil your fun, you poor silly? Who could miss knowing that big foot long nose of yours, let alone when it's all bandaged out like a basket of diapers? Suddenly, Mrs. Ardlett sank down on an old sofa whose torn cover was littered with movie and confession magazines, luring her swollen gray face into her fat braceleted arms. She began helplessly to cry. And Mrs. Ardlett thought, yes, there'll come the morning when you swallow that precious government whistle of yours altogether. And oh, then it'll be that I have to watch the split ends of its string disappearing like the sad whiskers of some modern snake down to investigate the congestion of still another apple in this crummy Eden. Moral. To the sanctimonious fellow who asked, what is more vilely depressing than the sight of a bad woman? Might not a charitable answer be, how dig ye the sight of a good one cut in two?